Hello, I'm Brian Warren.
And I'm Laurelyn Tyler Thompson. Welcome to the show.
Oh, today, Laurelyn, I love it because we're talking about the unseen. You know, so many times we think that we are just physical beings having a temporary spiritual experience, but we're really spiritual beings having a temporary physical experience, and we're not by ourselves. Yes. Have you ever had sort of this moment that you knew that you were like sort of a touched by an angel?
I don't know that I have, but I do know that I am careful to entertain strangers. You know how the Word of God says, you do not know who is an angel and who is not. So I am kind to people on the street, you know, somebody that you pass, perhaps that homeless person. Who knows what form an angel might take and how God is just presenting you with a little bit of miraculous into a very ordinary day.
Well, does the spiritual realm exist? The Bible says it does. And on today's show, we'll show you two riveting stories that deal with that question.
Dorothy Hartling and her husband would have lost their lives in an instant if it weren't for a mysterious knock at the door. You'll be shocked by the timely advice that they receive from the strange man at the door and his even stranger disappearance.
And in our other story, Tara Lawson. Yeah, her life was a nightmare after a fascination with Ouija boards turned into an invitation for trouble. The unexplainable got so out of control that all Tara could do was pray that God would save her. And God sure came in. He came through, and this is her frightening tale.
After watching a horror movie at the age of 12, Tara Lawson and her brother talked their mother into buying a Ouija board.
We just got a Parker Brothers Ouija board at the toy store, and we didn't realize that, you know, it was more than just a toy.
What started out as an innocent fascination turned Tara's life into a nightmare filled with oppression. An evil presence made itself known almost immediately.
It was moving her hands across the board, and it was moving really fast. And we were looking up at my dad, just kind of laughing, like, look, and we're not doing it.
It was spelling out this profanity. And they were looking up at me and laughing. And I was like, that sent some cold chills up your spine. So I said, give me that thing. I said, we're not playing this anymore. I said, I'm getting rid of it.
Tara's dad hid the board. It wasn't long, though, before Tara found it and secretly began playing again.
To me, it was just kind of something that was like a game, something that was just fun for me. I didn't realize the extent of the damage it could do in my life, what I was opening myself up to, that it was something demonic, something evil.
But the more she played, the more frightened she became.
I had it underneath my dresser. I would get so scared, I couldn't sleep, knowing it was under there.
She came back and said, you know, I found that Ouija board. I've been playing it again. And I can't sleep. It's bothering me. Would you please get rid of it?
Tara and her father burned the Ouija board. But a few years later, she was drawn back to it again. This time, she made her own Ouija board with a friend.
That one was even more powerful than the one before. Moved even stronger. It would say all kinds of wild stuff, and then it would just start saying all this inappropriate things. So being teenage girls, we just would kind of laugh and feel kind of uncomfortable, but we keep playing. And I could tell it was spelling something, but it was going so fast, I couldn't tell what it was spelling. But I saw my name, and it was saying, I'm going to kill you, Tara. I'm going to kill you, Tara, over and over. We ended up saying, our Father which art in heaven, is all we really knew to say. And it went to goodbye immediately.
She stopped playing with the Ouija board. But Tara's life was dominated by loneliness and fear.
I felt so alone. I felt like I didn't have anybody. It's almost like I was under this dark cloud of oppression. I opened that door to evil into my life. It brought in destruction. It brought in a dark oppression over my life. It seemed like everything from that point forward was spiraling downward.
Strange things occurred around her. Objects moved through her room at night. And loud noises would echo through the house when no one else was home.
I heard them stomping up and down the hall. And I thought, oh, my dad's home and he is not too happy. And so I ended up looking out in the hall and there was nobody there.
Tara eventually got married and moved out of the house. But the darkness went with her.
I would hear this loud evil chanting. I didn't understand the language. It didn't really sound like a human voice. It didn't sound like a human voice could talk in that tone and be that loud.
Then, late one night,
he was still up and I was asleep, and he looked in the hall and he saw this dark figure in the hall. And he ended up just saying a prayer to himself and it disappeared.
Tara's marriage eventually fell apart. One night as she slept, she had a vivid dream that she was violently murdered.
I closed my eyes and said, God, please get me out of here. I was like, please just save me. It just hit me that one day I'm gonna die. One day I'm gonna die and I don't know if I'm gonna go to heaven or hell. So I just started praying to God. I called out to him. I said, God, please, please show me what to do to be saved. I don't even know what to do, but I know I don't wanna go to hell.
The answer to her prayer came early the next day.
The next morning I hear a knock on the door, and I went to the door and there was a man standing there with a Bible. He said, I just wanted to come in and read some of the Bible with you and pray with you. And I was like, yeah. He read John 3:16 with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever shall believe in him shall have everlasting life.
Tara prayed to become a Christian. Her life was instantly transformed.
It changed everything. It's like everything woke up in me. It's like I was looking at things through new eyes, a new perspective, through his eyes. I mean, it was just, I was changing day by day. I've never felt that kind of love before in my life. And it was just amazing how quickly that transformation took place when his presence came into my life. It was darkness into light.
Tara is now a prayer counselor with the 700 Club. Her days of darkness are a distant memory, yet now serve as a warning to others.
The Ouija board was just an open door for all that that took place. And the only thing that stopped it was me turning my life over to Jesus. I feel like he's always there protecting me, and I don't have anything to worry about. He's right there guarding over me, looking after me. Even when I'm alone, I don't feel alone because I feel like he's right there with me, and he's never gonna leave me, he's never gonna forsake me. He made my life beautiful. He can make anyone's life beautiful.
Well, I'm telling you, that Ouija board stuff is not funny, and it opens the door to the enemy getting a stronghold in your life. Let me give you some information from the Word of God so that you know what you are up against. 2 Corinthians 11:14 says that he, the devil, masquerades as an angel of light and therefore can deceive you into believing that he is something that he is not. The Hebrew word for Lucifer is Hallel, which means brightness. He was created as the wisest and most beautiful creation, and then he tried to be God. You can read about the fall of Lucifer from the heavens in Ezekiel 28 as his pride drove him to try to usurp God from his throne. Isaiah 14:12 quotes Satan as he says, I will make myself like the Most High. 1 Peter 5:8 says that the enemy of ours, the devil, he roams around like a lion, roaring in fierce hunger, seeking someone to seize upon and devour. We must be wise to his schemes, not taking this lightly. John 10:10 says he is a thief who comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy you. He is also called the accuser of the brethren. Day and night in Revelations 12:10, he wants to bring condemnation over your life. This is a bad dude. He hates you. None of this is to be played with or taken lightly. So how do we fight him? Ephesians 6:11 says to put on the whole armor of God so that we can stand against the devil's schemes. I love this verse in James 4:7, which says to be subject or submitted to God, resist the enemy, and he will actually flee from you. It's a good day when the devil actually runs away from us. Right?
Well,
Brian?
It is. And the only reason he runs is because something bigger is inside of you.
We
greater
submit
is he
to God.
That is in us than he that is in the world. Mm-hmm. We want to get some information into your hands, though, about the occult. I mean, this is rampant in Canada because we have a theology even now that people don't even believe in those things anymore. And therefore, if you don't believe it, it can actually hide in your life. But I want to pray with you now, but I want you to call if you're battling with that darkness in your life and receive this. Father, we pray even now that you would shine your light in these homes, on these minds, and that Jesus, you would take residence and destroy the works of the devil in Jesus' name. Hey, the number's on the screen. If you're battling, who are you going to call? Ghostbusters? No, 700 Club Canada, 1-855-759-0700.
That's right.
God bless.
Daddy, Yeah, buddy.
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
There are times when you will be under direct fire from the enemy. I'm not talking about when you run out of gas or you lose your keys or some inconvenience like that. We all have those days. I'm talking about when the enemy who hates you and despises you, he roams about like a lion roaring, seeking someone to seize and devour. He's a bad guy and he's out to get you. He comes against you with what Ephesians 6:16 calls the fiery darts. The Amplified Version calls them flaming missiles of the wicked one. Let's talk about three pivotal ways that he does this. The first way is he tells you lies about your situation. He plants false insecurities and he tries to hit you where he knows you may have vulnerabilities. John 8:44 says this about him. When he speaks a falsehood, he speaks what is natural to him. He is a liar and the father of lies. You cannot believe one word that this serpent speaks to your heart and your mind. He will diminish you and attempt to weaken your faith. He'll try to tell you that who you are is not what the word of God says that you are. You are born to reign. We are more than conquerors to him who has called us according to his purpose. Number two, the second way that the enemy goes after you is highlighted in Daniel 7:25. It says, "And he shall speak words against the Most High God and shall wear out the saints." The enemy wants to steal your rest. He wants to wear you out. So how do you combat that attack? Isaiah 40:31. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. So practically speaking, when you begin to feel an exhaustion overtaking you, realize this may not be just your busy schedule. The enemy wants to trap you into a life full of stress, pressure, and anxiety. The third way that the enemy attacks us is through sending temptations that easily seem to grab our attention. These are sins that we are particularly vulnerable to. The Bible calls them besetting sins. For some of us, that may be stealing. For another, it's pornography. For another, it's being critical or gossiping. There are familiar spirits who know you very well. They will craft a snare of deception for your soul to keep you from walking in victory and attaining all that God intends for your life. I want to end with a quote from the book by Francis Frangipane, The Three Battlegrounds. This is what he wrote, and I love it. Satan will not continue to assault you if the circumstances he designed to destroy you are now working to perfect you. Isn't that amazing? If you demolish the lies of the enemy and you speak only the truth, if you live a balanced life using your time wisely and walking in God's rest, and when you resist temptation by taking the way of escape that God will provide for you, the devil will just get frustrated in trying to defeat you and he will leave you alone.
Amen. You know, John 10:10, the enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but I have come that you might have life and to have life more abundantly. Remember, he's more like you than he is like God. He's not omnipotent, he's not omniscient, and he's not omnipresent. You can handle him because Jesus gives you the power, and we're praying for you. Call the number on the screen. Up next, Nikki is here with some important information to avoid injury.
Hi, I'm Nikki. Welcome to the Get Up and Get Moving segment. Each week, I'll present three moves that are designed to get your heart rate up, increase your strength, and improve your flexibility. These are moves that are meant for anyone to do at any time with minimal equipment. So there's no excuses. You just have to get up and get moving. Before we get started, I want to remind you to think about your core muscles. So throughout the day, it doesn't have to just be in your workout. You can think about it while you're sitting at your desk, when you're getting up, when you're reaching over for something. Think about pulling your belly button into your spine because your entire day can be an exercise move. Your core is strong, you're less likely to be injured. Your lower back, a lot of people shoveling their driveway, doing gardening, golfing. These are the things that tend to irritate your lower back. If you're thinking about your core, keeping everything nice and strong, you're less likely to be injured. So consider your core throughout your day for less injury. Okay, moving on. This is a tough one today. All right, I'm challenging you to get a little bit more intense. We've got the ball down on the ground. These are squat jumps, okay? So if this is way too intense, I want you to start here, just coming up onto your toes, okay? So you're in a squat rise. The key with the squat, again, is that your seat's going directly behind you, like you're gonna sit down on a chair, you stand back up. Up and down, up and down. We're gonna take this up a notch. We're gonna add a jump up. So you're adding some power, okay? Up and down. Try to do 12 to 15 of those. Up, press the ball up, and up, okay? So that one's tough. So either just up on your toes or adding the power. Even doing a couple of them, it's gonna get your heart rate up. You're gonna notice a big increase in your ability to do some of these cardio moves. Okay, moving on into our strength section. Again, this is a challenge. It's a challenge for your core. So we're going into a push-up, then a pike, and a knee pull-in. You're putting all three of these moves together. We've done these before. Push-up, pike, seat goes in the air, and knee pull-in. Again, down we go. Push-up, pike, knee pull-in. Try to do 12 of these. One more. Down, pike, knee pulling. You're good to go. That's tough. Do a couple of those to start out with and gradually move up. Now we're stretching over your ball, hanging down, letting your body stretch right out. Take a deep breath in and exhale, relax. Very good. It's a great stretch. Hold on to that stretch for 15 or 20 seconds. Remember to go to 700club.ca. For more exercise ideas, you could be putting together a great fitness plan there with all different kinds of cardio, strength, and stretch movements. Okay, and come to NikkiCanelon.com. If you have any comments or questions, I'd love to hear from you. So remember, get up and get moving today. You'll be so glad you did. See you next time.
Thanks, Nikki. Avoiding injuries is always important. Here at the 700 Club Canada, we are committed to sharing stories of hope to the hurting in Canada. And I want to invite you to be a part of what we're doing right here. If you have a desire to help those in need and to change lives, then call today and become a partner with the 700 Club Canada. And when you do, you'll be a part of all the wonderful things that are taking place right here in Canada. Mm.
For just $20 a month, you can become a 700 Club Canada partner. Or if you're able to give more, you can join at a higher level, such as the 700 Club Canada Gold Partner, which is $40 a month.
And we would appreciate your monthly gift as well. And as a thank you for your generosity, we'll send you a DVD, this new DVD entitled The Three Blessings. In this latest teaching of Pat Robertson, he shares with you three blessings that he has asked of God himself: wisdom, favor, and anointing. Now, Pat shows us how to think in prayer and also teaches you how the three blessings can have a lifelong lasting impact in your life.
Also, if you join Pledge Express, which is an automatic donation from your bank or credit card, you'll also receive The Jewish Jesus by Gordon Robertson, a new DVD that looks at more than 50 Old Testament prophecies that tell the story of Jesus of Nazareth long before he walked the earth.
So don't wait. Call now, 1-855-759-0700, and operators are standing by, and you can be a part of this growing army of people who want to be life changers right here in Canada.
They can protect you, bring you great happiness, and add years to your life. They will free you from fear, fill your life with peace and well-being, and bring you success. They're a treasure, a weapon, and better than gold.
Welcome back. Up next, Dorothy Hartling's home was about to explode if it weren't for a mysterious knock at the door.
I had prior, like, been on chemotherapy and radiation, and it was breast cancer and bladder cancer. And they wanted to operate on me before Christmas to remove, you know, multiple cysts that were obviously, cancerous. So I asked for a second opinion, and they sent me to Sunnybrook Hospital in Toronto, and they operated, but they did not find the multiple cysts. So we decided we would have a little treat for ourselves. So we thought we would look into having a fireplace installed in our home. And so, however, the inspectors, they came and inspected everything, and so they were, just as they were leaving, they said, now you can turn on the gas. And so we were about to turn on the gas, and there was an interruption of somebody knocking on the door. And we're wondering, you know. However, we opened the door, and the inspectors who had just finished inspecting the gas, they were just pulling out of the driveway, and this other person at the front door saying, we need to call the consumer's gas and have them come back over quickly. And he spoke with authority. We couldn't question, he just seemed to have authority that we must phone the consumer's gas. And he just shone. I saw this glow on his face, and I wanted to ask him, are you a Christian? But I think he was sent by the Lord. I was thinking about, he looked so different, like he was filled with love and compassion. And as soon as we closed the door, we have these huge windows right beside the door. And so my husband and I did particularly, look out the window because, it's a big window. And he was nowhere to be seen. Like, we had this huge big driveway and steps, a big veranda, he did not walk down the steps or down the driveway. There was no car, and he just disappeared. So he would have had to jump over the rail, so why would he do that? We have a huge veranda, right? Like about, 8 cement steps type of thing off the veranda. And then you have to take 5 or 6 steps before you get to the steps itself, And then we have a huge driveway. Okay, maybe, possibly he doesn't own a car. But, I mean, where could he go? I mean, we moved within a second, less than that, going from the door to the window. So where could he go? We were both at the door, and we closed the door. And I said to my husband, could he have been an angel? And my husband quickly ran to the phone. And he phoned the consumer's gas, and they sent somebody over very quickly. And they came over, and they said the fumes from the gas were surrounding the house. There could have been an explosion. And so we just praised the Lord. It could have been devastating, because we had a fire prior to that, some while ago prior. And he was definitely an angel. God does send angels. Yes, there was a fire, and I was going through cancer at the same time. My husband passed away. The truth is, what the devil means for evil, I mean, God didn't cause the cancer. Cancer came about. So if I had to go into depression and anxiety, things could have gotten worse. All the blessings that we have on this earth have come from God. Every blessing we have. And we've got to give God the glory, because there are angels. I've seen many angels, but I've given this one today as an example.
I love that. You know, people are asking, is God moving in Canada? Right here, this is proof positive. When you look at Dorothy Hartling, we recognize that she was saying, where did this guy go? It was an angel. Now, some of you might say, oh, no, you know what? Couldn't be an angel. You got to get me right there to Sunnybrook, and I got to see all these other things. No, whatever that is. If you believe it's an angel, I believe it's an angel as well. The Bible says, especially right after Jesus rose from the dead, angels were everywhere in Scripture. Look what it says in Acts chapter 12. And it says, Peter himself, in Acts chapter 12, verse 7, and suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared standing beside him, and a light shone around him and where he was. And an angel gently smote him on the side, and he awakened him. He said, get up quickly, and the chains fell off. And then he walks him out. The church is praying, and then all of a sudden, Peter rises up, and God is literally delivering him out of a difficult situation. There are angels around you right now, and they're in Canada. So let's get rid of that stinking thinking and that criticism and start saying, God, I've got faith. I believe you can do anything.
I love it. You know, the Word of God says that He will give His angels charge over you.
Amen.
They have charge over us. And, you know, just last night, Brian, I had a situation going on in my family, and I literally prayed that angels would go to my home where I am not and would take charge of situations going on there, that they would just be in control. And I pray for angels that protect me. I like to think, Brian, that wherever we go, we got our accompaniment. We got our angels going with
us. That's the army of heaven, because we think we have to fight. All you got to do is press 911. I got a crazy thing happening right now, God. Could you send those angels? Holy Ghost, would you just do that? I mean, that's how we roll. Don't get it twisted. I mean, Canada, we got to start believing what God's doing. We're spiritual, but now it's time for us to get into the kingdom.
Yes.
Well, we look forward to being with you all again. If you've missed any of our shows, and even today's show, and want past episodes, watch us at 700club.ca.
It's been a pleasure spending this day with you. We'll see you next time. I'm Laurel and Tyler Thompson.
I'm Brian Warren.
See you next time.
To contact us, mail Christian Broadcasting Associates Incorporated, the 700 Club Canada, P.O. Box 700, Scarborough, Ontario, M1S4T4.
Hebrew prophets foretold his coming. Welcomed as a king, killed as a criminal, and 3 days later, he would rise from the dead. The Jewish Jesus. In this Emmy-nominated series, Gordon Robertson examines over 50 Old Testament prophecies that tell the story of Jesus of Nazareth. Get the Jewish Jesus today, including a special bonus feature, The Family of Jesus. It's our gift to you when you join Pledge Express.